Let's check this out. Enjoy.
New music that's being produced, whether it's by artists who have a long history or by new artists. And so it's always interesting for me to explore those avenues, and that keeps me excited. What kept me excited at the beginning, or what got me going in the beginning, and what keeps me going now. I like to hear innovations, you know, whether it's in terms of sound or songwriting or whatever it is. When I say innovation, it doesn't necessarily mean a new way of doing things. It could be that, but it also may be a great voice, a really great singer, for instance, who has a unique quality, or a songwriter who has a unique quality. It's not just about the sound. The technique's really important as well. And I think there will be new things always, because there are new brains always, you know. And of course, it's easy these days to make good music, but it's as difficult as always to make great, you know, special music. One of the things I think that's problematic with innovation in electronic music is there are too many libraries, too many loop libraries, too many sample libraries, too many presets. When you buy a software synth, there are too many presets. So you're always drawn, it's always an easier option to use something that's been used before. And that's something that I've always been, when I've ever worked with people in the studio, I've been very strict about not using those things, because making electronic music is making the sound. And it's you know, it's a composition, what you do with the sound, but it's making the sound as well. And if you use other people's sounds all the time, you're never going to have a really original sound. There's a certain thing about those classic, you know, 909, 808, Juno, MS-20, whatever, all that era, they do work musically together. So in a way, it's an easy option. And sometimes it's not a bad option. It depends what else is going on. I mean, if you have that as a basis with other more interesting things, that's okay, you know. I mean, I think what's interesting about things like Reactor and Max for Live is there's incredible community building these weird devices that you can download and try for yourself. I mean, personally, I'm not into building those things. It's just that I'm not that technical, and life's too short to learn those things. But I'm really grateful to all those people who do spend a lot of time and energy really being creative. And I tend to use those, really, especially now, the Max for Live, because I'm an Ableton user, and Max for Live because it integrates so well. And there's some really great things, and you know, you can combine them in ways that it's kind of modular in a way, like a modular analog modular in a way. You can combine things in a way that are unique to yourself, even though you don't build the devices yourself. Technical development and the development of music have always gone hand in hand since, for 1,000 years or more. You know, the invention of the piano, the saxophone, the guitar. I mean, it's all technology, electric guitar. And they go hand in hand. You can't separate technology and music, really. At home in London, I've got more kind of bigger modular systems, which we don't have at the studio because people never use it, to be honest, which I bought at various times. But there was a really great time, I would say, between 1983 and 1988, roughly, which was the period between the invention or the release of the DX7 and the beginning of Acid House. In these years, everybody threw away their analog synthesizers because they thought that, you know, digital synthesizers were the future. You know, they stayed in tune, they had all these great electric piano sounds and bass, funky bass sounds, and they just got rid of all their analog gear. And I got, you know, at that time you could really pick up things from the street almost. And universities all got rid of their stuff. I got a great EMS Synthy 100. I don't know if you know that. It's, you know, it's a dream synthesizer for somebody like me. They practically gave it to me. They just said, just take it away, you know. It's so big, takes up too much space. You know, I mean, I couldn't believe it, you know. And then when Acid House came and all the kind of, you know, 303 sounds and analog kind of came back, and everybody started going, oh my God, you know, and then the prices went zooming up again, you know. It's very funny. So I was lucky to be around at that time with a few quid in the bank to take advantage of it.
Warm leatherette. Warm leatherette. Warm.
I never thought of myself as a musician, really. I mean, when I was a kid, everybody in that period in the 60s, everybody was in a band. Everybody was inspired by the music that was going on, you know, the Beatles, the Stones, the Kinks, Who, etc. And everybody in school, in my class, was in a band. And obviously the good musicians gravitated together and the bad musicians gravitated together. And I was definitely not a good musician. So we had a band of bad musicians, but we had a really fun time. You know, conventional guitar, bass, drums. And I was kind of frustrated because I was a frustrated musician because I had a lot of ideas and there were lots of kind of music that I wanted to be able to play, which I just simply couldn't play. So, and neither could my bandmates. So we ended up pretty much a blues-based band in a kind of funny way. But and I never really wrote songs or we played other people's songs. So, you know, my dream later on was to own a synthesizer and a tape recorder. It became very easy for me to put some of my ideas down on tape in a way that I could never have done before. And that was very exciting for me, but I never really wrote songs. It was more just about ideas. And then when I decided that I did want to make a single, I managed to write two songs, and that's about it. And the two songs were on the first single. And then the Silicon Teens, of course, was cover versions. And the other project, a duet MO with Bruce Gilbert and Graham Lewis, was more like a... Well, Graham Lewis wrote the lyrics. They were the two guys from Wire, who I was friendly with. And we just did the music kind of jamming together. And I actually realised at a certain point quite early on that what I really enjoyed doing more was working with musicians to help them achieve their goals rather than me trying to do it myself.
TVOD, TVOD, TVOD.
I never thought of myself really as a producer in the traditional sense. Most of the things I did were, I would say, more like collaboration. So I was like another person in the studio. I did most of my work with Depeche Mode in the early 80s. I did some stuff with Fad Gadget, but very little else really. We did 5 Depeche albums in 5 years, basically, which is a lot. And that kind of took it out of me. And I was, at that point, I really wanted to concentrate on running the label more because, you know, we had a few great artists, but I wasn't signing anything. I was kind of a bit out of touch with music for a couple of years because I was in the studio so much. And a rule that I gave myself, you could say it's a good rule or a bad rule, is that when I was making a record, I would never listen to any other music. Because, you know, if you have a bad day in the studio, you think everything's shit, and then you listen to something, you think, oh, that's really great, and then you get really depressed, and you think, we'll never do anything as good as that. So I just kind of, I stop listening to music when I'm in the studio, and just kind of be in the world, be in the musical world of the project. And so I stopped producing, and just carried on really concentrating more on the label. First of all, when I started, I knew nothing about anything about the music business, you know, and that was a great feeling. And there were a lot of people, contemporaries of mine, you know, people like Tony Wilson or Martin Mills or Jeff Travis, 4AD, you know, Factory, Ivo Watts-Russell, all kind of in the same boat. We were all roughly the same age, mid-20s. We were all inspired by punk and what that possibilities were and knew nothing about what we were doing, but kind of did it purely from instinct. And so there was, you know, that kind of, I suppose you could call it pioneering spirit or amateur spirit, you know, was very strong there. And obviously, as much as I try and retain some of that over a long period of time, you know, you do lose it and you learn stuff and sometimes you learn too much stuff. And the good thing about I guess, not just the music industry, but every industry these days, is you have to keep, there's so many changes, you have to keep relearning all the time, which is one of the things that's kind of exciting about it. I mean, there's no comparison, really, between my situation in 1978 and my situation in 2014. There's so little to compare it to. I don't even... Of course, I miss those days, because they were exciting times, and, you know, you look back with, you know, rose-tinted glasses, they're, you know, as always, and they were exciting times, but these are challenging, exciting times, too.
Thank you.
You're welcome.